Hello, my name is Adrian Daly. I work at the Department of Endocrinology at the University of Liège in Belgium. And endocrine-related cancer have given me this chance today to talk about one of our recent publications in that journal on the topic of gigantism. A little bit of background on our work. We have a specific interest in aggressive forms of pituitary tumours. Those would be cases that affect families, such as syndromes like familial isolated pituitary adenomas, or FIPA. That's a condition that was described in Liège by the head of our group, Albert Beckers, a number of years ago. Now, we've also an interest in pituitary adenomas that have an aggressive profile occurring in children. And those pituitary adenomas often have a particular clinical profile or characteristics that set them apart from other pituitary adenomas, even of the same cell type, occurring in adults. So this particular study was on a form of gigantism that we described at the end of 2014 in a collaboration between our group and that of Konstantin Stratakis at the NIH. And this form of acrogigantism, which we termed X-linked acrogigantism, or X-LAG for short, that's a condition that's quite unlike other forms of gigantism or acromegaly caused by pituitary adenomas secreting growth hormone. The characteristics of X-LAG are that it, instead of affecting patients who are later teens or young adults, as other genetic forms often do, patients with X-LAG syndrome begin to suffer from their condition within the first 12 months of life. And thereafter, they suffer a very severe overgrowth syndrome. Interestingly, a number of patients in the historical literature, such as the ones shown here, the tallest man and woman in recorded human history, had a clinical presentation that was very similar to the patients that we have since described with X-LAG syndrome. So we believe that this is a clinical entity that, while rare, leads to an exceptionally severe phenotype. What occurs with these patients is they develop a pituitary hyperplasia and pituitary adenomas that secrete very high levels of growth hormone and usually prolactin, beginning, as I said, in the first 12 months of life. They're usually diagnosed by the age of 3. It's a difficult disease to treat, not only because they're very, very young patients, they have quite large tumours for being young, and often those tumours are quite resistant to a number of medical therapies. So they tend to require quite aggressive neurosurgery, which itself has long-term problems. X-LAG syndrome has an unusual genetic etiology as well. Usually tumours causing tumours of the pituitary gland that have a genetic component, they're usually caused by mutations in certain genes, whereas X-LAG syndrome, rather than a mutation or a deletion, is actually caused by a duplication on chromosome X, which involves a gene, the causative gene is GPR101. This is a new orphan G-protein coupled receptor that is still undergoing a lot of studies at the moment by our group and many others, to understand how it works. It's overexpressed in the pituitaries of patients with X-LAG syndrome, but also there are some studies and some interesting data from our group at least, and some data coming from others, that indicates that perhaps X-LAG also affects higher levels of endocrine control, perhaps at the hypothalamic level via growth hormone releasing hormone. So those are studies for another day, and certainly many other studies will be published on this topic. But I wanted to come back to this current study that you can see here. Here's the title, and it's Somatic Mosaicism Underlies X-Linked Acrogigantism Syndrome, X-LAG Syndrome, in Sporadic Male Subjects. And when we were going through our first 18 patients with X-LAG syndrome, we noticed something very peculiar in three sporadic males. These are males who had no family history, they did not come from FIPA kindreds, and their background, family background, had normal height and had no history of pituitary adenomas. instead of having a full duplication like other XLAG patients, as you can see here in this figure, the red line shows what the theoretic duplication should look like. This LR, this log 2 ratio, should have been 1 in males. But in these three cases, it came in below that level, which indicated that they did not have a full duplication in all of their cells. And in fact, actually quite low levels, nearly down to perhaps a quarter of their cells would have been affected. And the only really logical explanation for this, after studying it in our lab and at other collaborating labs, was that these were in fact mosaics. They had a variable proportion of their cells that were affected with the duplication. And in fact, if you look at the lower of these patients, they had a very low level of duplication. So these patients who had dramatic forms of gigantism, these were some very, very tall children, adolescents and adults, some of the tallest currently that have been described. These patients, in fact, were walking around with as low as 25% of their cells duplicated. So this appears to be a very strong pro-growth signal when it's duplicated. And it may be that specific nuclei, either in the hypothalamus or elsewhere in the brain or in the pituitary itself, are exquisitely sensitive to copy number variation of GPR101 during development and early childhood, leading to this dramatic overgrowth syndrome. We used two different forms of digital PCR, a specific technique that is very useful for highlighting quite small numbers of either mutation, copy number variation, deletion and duplication. And we used a specific digital PCR method for each patient, and that was performed at the lab of Dr. Lupski at Baylor College of Medicine. And we developed a second digital PCR, which was more of a screening PCR, that looked at copy numbers of the gene GPR101 as they compared to a standard reference gene, ZIC3, which is never duplicated in XLAG syndrome. So those helped us actually lower the level of duplication that was seen in these patients, and in fact as low as 16% of cells are affected via the digital PCR method in these somatic males. So it's actually a very low threshold to actually cause what we would see as a dramatic form of gigantism. Using our screening, what we call our screening digital PCR method, we were able to actually diagnose a new patient with XLAG, and this would have given us hope that such techniques could be used perhaps to screen large numbers of acromegaly patients or patients with gigantism using this technique, which is quite relatively easy to use and apply in genetic labs. And we would urge you to read the paper, go to the Endocrine-Related Cancer website and have a look at this and other publications from endocrine-related cancer researchers. And we would urge you also to study endocrine-related cancer on a regular basis, because there are some fantastic articles there, and consider it for your very best manuscripts and your very best data, as it's a really good modern journal. So thank you very much.